Hey everyone, I am so excited for this interview. Seriously, this is a person that really inspires me a lot, and I think you're gonna get some amazing stuff out of this interview and just understanding her business and her heart and her passion behind what she does and getting to meet her and some of her products. So Chaitra, I'm gonna let you just introduce yourself and tell people kind of what you do and maybe a little bit about how you got your start with your current brand or anything even before your current brand that you wanna share with us.
Yeah, hey everyone, hey Regina, thanks so much for first of all having me here. I'm so glad. I'm Chaitra from itspinkpod.com. Pinkpod is a design and photography studio for bloggers and creative entrepreneurs. So there are two parts to my brand and business. I work on design as well as photography. So design is something that, so I went to school for, I'm an engineer, so I went to school and learned coding and all those geeky things. So I'm good at that. But photography is something that is I taught myself, and it was something I didn't know at all. And once I got into the blogging world, that is when I started developing interest in photography. So now I work with creative entrepreneurs on creating beautiful websites, their beautiful brands, and you know, WordPress websites for their brand and business. And also I have a photography business called Creative Convex, which where I create style stock photography for brands. And yeah, I now recently also started teaching photography. So that is very exciting. Yeah.
So awesome. Okay, so two things. Tell us just maybe like a random fact about yourself that we maybe wouldn't know by just following your blog online. And then secondly, can you specify what are the ways that you monetize your brands right now?
Okay, yeah. So random fact, I don't know really where to start, but I'm from India. I came to the US just about 3 years ago, and I started my blog within 6 months of coming here. So US is like my headquarters, I'd say, for my business. Yeah, that's one thing. But yeah, one more thing is I was never into photography. I would see all my friends with big DSLRs and stuff, and I would be probably least interested in what's going on over there. I always wanted to be in front of the camera, never behind it. So blogging got me into photography. It was totally new to me. Those two facts. But apart from that, coming to monetization. So first, when I started my blog as this hobby beauty blog, it's so funny that to see how far I've come from there. I started Pinkpot as a beauty and lifestyle blog, but soon I was more interested in the photography and design aspects of, you know, blogging. Like I always wanted to tweak blog designs, and I always wanted to take better photos of, you know, the beauty products I was talking about. So yeah, so that's how I started. So the first thing I think monetization, I first started my Etsy shop offering, you know, blog design templates for the blogger.com platform. So that's the first way I started monetizing my, I started a business, if to say, yeah. But then started my Etsy shop within 4 months. That took off really well. I had no expectations, but that took off really well. I have to say that took off well. And from there, it was at the same time I had to quit my job as well. Okay. Because my program was coming to an end. I was like, should I continue my... I was doing a research program at Carnegie Mellon University. I was working there as a research scholar. So
awesome.
Everything came together. And after that, it was up to me if I wanted to, you know, pursue my blog, the Etsy shop, which I had, or I wanted to go into a full-time software job like Google or the typical corporate thing. Yeah, actually Google had been my dream job all the time. I always wanted to get into Google, but then since it started my Etsy shop, I was like, oh my God, people are actually buying things which I'm creating. I was like, so, you know, those first few sales which I made, I literally couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
So I decided that, you know, I've done all my life. I've just studied. I've just done the typical things I had to do. But now I'm just going to take 1 year off and just try to do the thing which I probably love. I want to do everything on my own terms. I just create, design, blog, everything on my own terms. So I'll just give 1 year to myself And let's see how this goes. So my main idea that time was to just start a proper graphic design or web design business on my blog.
Yeah.
Until then, I had just my Etsy shop. So yeah, this was my new venture that I was going to quit my job and do.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, so I quit my job in, the last day of my job was in August, and I started my new business in October. So from then, even till now, I offer web design and development services. So that's how I monetize my business. So Etsy shop, the design business, those two things were the main ways I was monetizing. And and then this year in 2016, I branched out into photography products and services. So this year I've been offering like custom photography sessions for brands where I take styled brand photos for small businesses and creative businesses in our industry. And that, and I also launched a stock photography. Oh my God, how many things have I launched this year? Yeah, and then I launched the stock photography shop.
Yeah.
It's called the Creative Convex Shop, where I sell, you know, styled brand photos, stock photos, as well as mock-ups for people to purchase and use for their website. So these two things. And just 2 weeks ago, I launched my iPhone photography course. So this was my first course, finally launched it. So I have to say this. So 2 years ago, I think exactly when I was planning to, not 2 years ago, I think 1.5 years ago, when I was planning to make this switch into full-time business, I remember that you were offering these brand reviews on Periscope, I think. And and you were just going through my brand and you said, girl, your photos are really good. Why don't you create some products around photography? Why don't you go create a small course or something just to get started off with like Instagram photography or something like that? And that idea kind of stuck with me throughout, but it took me like one and a half years to kind of like even get started on it and do something, because I was really busy with, you know, the design and development projects. And this idea was always there at the back of my mind, but with client projects and everything, it's really hard to sit down and create a course. So I always wanted to do it. I just kept reading so much, consuming so much information about creating courses, but I never got started.
Yeah.
And then I was like, you know what, if I don't do this now, I don't know when I'll do it. And I don't care if it's going to be perfect. I don't care if I'm going to have this big, huge launch, but I just want to get it out there. You know, this year is going to be getting it out there. I'm just going to do the hard work and create the course and get it out there. And then we'll think about the rest next year. So that's where I am at right now. Yeah,
I love it. So can you, I think there are going to be a lot of people listening who can really relate to this concept of, I already work full time. What are you saying? You want me to create a course or create an ebook or whatever it is that they might be thinking about? Because a lot of people, what we're really trying to do is find ways to increase our income that don't increase our stress and our workload over the long term. There's always going to be some work related to getting a product out or getting a service out. But at the end of the day, like, most of us just want more time to take care of our families, to take care of our health, and to maybe have some freedom, which is, I'm assuming, you know, why you said, I don't want the corporate job. I'm just gonna, you know, see where this Etsy shop goes. So I'm sure, you know, you probably even think it's a good idea to get started early with your ideas, you know, before it's an absolute must, you know, maybe start a blog or start experimenting, because that seems to be what you did. You had an Etsy shop going and you're like, wait, people are buying. Maybe I could, you know, make a full-time income. But here's what I want to ask is, how did you have either you're going, you know, in this, you're in this program full-time and you're trying to do an Etsy shop on the side, or fast forward to where you're operating a client-based business full-time and you want to create a course on the side, how in the heck did you do that?
So obviously I sat on the idea for a long time. I didn't jump into creating the course because I knew that it was a huge thing and I didn't want to just do something just for the heck of it. I really wanted to provide a lot of value through the course. If I was going to make it, I was going to do it the right way. I just didn't want to do something very quick. So, but I also knew that if I was not going to put a date on it, then I was not going to do it. Right. Yeah. I, I, It was almost 1.5 years, and I had not done anything about it except learning how to create a course, how to do this, how to do that, but I hadn't done anything. So then I was like, once I finished launching my stock shop in July, I was like, you know what? I'm going to try this course thing, because it was like in the middle of the year, and I had 6 more months for 2016 to end. So I was like, you know, I'm going to slow down on the client projects. I'm not going to take any client projects for the last 3 months of this year. So for like September, October, November, and December, I'm going to start taking again. But, you know, these 3 months, I'm not going to do any client work.
Perfect.
Take on new projects. I'm just going to I'm going to concentrate on the course.
Right.
The course is going to be my project, and I'm going to, you know, I'm just going to go. It's a big risk. I don't know if the course is going to work. I don't know. And
right.
I'm not going to take client projects. And so that means I'm not going to make much income during these 3 months. But it's a risk. And I think sometimes as an entrepreneur, you got to take that risk.
Sure.
Just if it's going to make you happy. But one thing I knew was creating this course is going to make me happy. So you got to balance the income thing and the happiness thing. I just wanted to give it a try. And I've always been about experimenting in my business. I want to experiment. I want to see. If it fails, that's fine. I know I'm going to get bummed for a day or a little more than that. But, you know, just get on with it. And it's more about experimenting. So this year, I just decided to do it. And I put a date. I think I announced it sometime in August. And then I said, I'm going to launch it before I go out for holiday in December. And I'm going 3 days, I'm going day after tomorrow. So I just launched it in time and got the launch done. So
That's
yeah, I had
awesome.
Put it, yeah. But I had to put a stop on client projects. I did work on client work on the projects which I'd taken prior to August.
Right.
But yeah, but I didn't do well. I was juggling just 2 projects over these 3 months
okay.
when I was doing coursework. So I would allot 4 hours at least every day on the course, and I would do the rest. You know, I use the rest of the time for client work. And obviously, I couldn't do a lot of things as planned because obviously time is limited, and there was only this much I could do. But whatever I gave it my best. So yeah,
right.
that's the thing. Yeah.
So it's like you bring up a good point, really, for a lot of us solopreneurs or creative entrepreneurs. I think it's something that we don't pay enough attention to. So like in the startup world and in the big business world, people, CEOs and people understand the concept of kind of like innovate or die, so to speak, where if you're not constantly moving forward, like standing still in business is moving backwards. You know, which a lot of people don't always think of because it's a lot to juggle. Like, wait, I just started making a full-time income, or I just started learning how to get clients. You want me to do something else? So there's like a balance between doing what you're currently doing really well, because if you weren't serving your clients really well, and if you weren't putting out really beautiful design projects, which you do, then you're not really building a strong base for yourself to grow from. But at the same time, if you don't think, you know, forward, like, huh, what can I create that takes this all to the next level for people? And for me as a brand owner, like, you kind of have to balance those things. And so you chose to branch out by creating a course, which allows you to help more people at the same time. You know, 10 people could take your course, but also 100 people or 1,000 people. And what's great is you've now created a product that maybe you got busy and you weren't able to put as much effort to the promotion and launch as you wanted to, but now the product exists. So you can go back and you can put more effort to promotion and to launching. So it's like you've created this thing that can work for you far beyond its initial, you know, launch.
Yeah.
So, which is awesome. So tell us specifically some of the things that you built into your course. What was important to you as far as providing content or experience to your students? What framework were you thinking through of how people are going to process and use your information? What inspired you? Like, tell us all the things. Yeah.
Yeah. So obviously a lot of people in our industry think you need a DSLR to take photos. And that's, I mean, you definitely, DSLR is a huge plus and it's amazing to take, it provides amazing high quality photos, but that doesn't mean that you cannot take good photos using something that you already have. And they say that the best camera is the one that you already have. It's not the one in the store that you got to go and buy, but it's probably the one in your hand already. And most of us have iPhones or any smartphone, and smartphones come with amazing camera quality and great photos these days. So I just wanted to put that point across. And most people, especially when you're starting your business, you aren't ready to invest $600 to $1,000 in a DSLR. So I wanted to show what's possible with your smartphone. And yeah, that was my main interest. And that was my main intention of kind of delivering that point across and saying that you don't have to spend a lot of money. You just have to use your iPhone that's already there. You don't have to spend any extra money. And you can take high, sometimes it is really difficult to spot the difference between photos taken on an iPhone and a DSLR if you've done it well. I mean, if you know the right techniques,
yeah.
I think, yeah, you can take much better photos with your iPhone than a person who doesn't know the techniques well does with a DSLR. So yeah, I just wanted to get that point across. That was my main intention through this, you know, this whole iPhone photography course. And yeah, that was my main thing. And that's how I got started.
Yeah.
So
I love
yeah.
that. How did you tell us, how did you promote the course? What different platforms do you exist in as a brand owner online? And which ones did you use to promote your course? And like, what did you do inside of those platforms?
So my main promotion for promotion, I mainly use email marketing.
Okay.
So basically my email list. I just use, I think that was the only thing, in fact, I used for promoting my course this time. But I also used to kind of share behind the scenes and everything on Instagram. So Instagram and email list were probably the main things. But also one important thing I did was I basically wanted people to get going on taking photos on their, you know, iPhone, because it, one thing is to think about taking photos on an iPhone.
Right.
Another thing is to actually go out there and see that you can do it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So 2 weeks before the launch, I had this idea of creating a challenge
yeah.
of, you know, motivating people to take out their iPhones and start clicking photos for their Instagram and blog and everything. So I created this challenge. It was a 7-day iPhone to Instagram challenge. So you every day for 7 days, I sent a mini iPhone photography lesson,
uh-huh.
Of course, through email marketing. I just sent a broadcast email, and around 400 people had signed up for the challenge.
Yeah.
And they took the challenge, and at least around, and I would like to believe at least 60 to 100 people did the challenge,
great.
You know, every single day. Yeah, that was really good. I really saw that people were interested, and that kind of inspired me. I'm like, maybe I'm on the right track on this course. Maybe people are interested.
Yeah.
And yeah, that course was that challenge was really helpful in getting people to actually believe in the concept of iPhone photography. They were really excited with the results they were getting. So all they had to do was just follow that actionable lesson I sent that day, take a photo on their iPhone and upload it onto Instagram.
Wow.
And that, uh-huh. yeah, that kind of created a nice community as well.
Yeah.
And we had this Facebook group for that challenge with the people who took the challenge, and the Facebook group was really instrumental. So yeah, if that counts as one of the platforms that I use, then Facebook group was really helpful to kind of promote that, you know, just motivate everyone and just get everyone excited about it and interested in the concept. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's so funny because in saying this one thing, you've pulled out probably three super important concepts that I could hear. And I want to kind of expand on them for people listening, which is this concept of self-efficacy. And I'll get into that in a second. But then you also brought in a community feel, because a lot of people feel like they're learning things on an island and they're testing out things and growing on an island, and it can really not be that. It can be a community. And then you also kind of had this way of proving that you can actually teach these concepts all within this one challenge. So self-efficacy, what I mean there by point one is that you gave people simple instructions, and then they're like, oh, snap a photo, maybe edit it, post it, Oh, I have more content on my Instagram. Three people liked it. Yay. So there's this sense of so for me, getting more into fitness and trying to help people with fitness over the last few months, it's like you don't come in and have your client do the most challenging yoga asana or posture ever first. It's not like, all right, let's do headstands. It's like, let's do this. Let's do child's pose. And then you feel confident in that. So it's like moving people along by having them go, huh, I did that little step. Maybe I can do this next one. So that's an amazing thing you did with the challenge. Second thing you provided was community, because it can feel so lonely on this journey, whatever people are passionate about. I'm sure you had people who were beauty bloggers and people who were business bloggers, people who were healthy living bloggers and people who were paper bloggers, But a lot of times you can feel like, man, I'm the only paper blogger in the world. But then you get to be a part of a community, and maybe you don't meet someone exactly like yourself, but you can meet people that are similar or that have the same frustrations or fears. And it can just feel so great to get connected. And then finally, by you delivering these 7 days worth of emails, people are probably seeing a very beautiful email. I didn't get actually didn't see your challenge, so I didn't get to sign up for it. But I'm assuming, because I know your work, the email was pretty, the instructions were clear, and so people are learning to see you as a teacher that can help them accomplish a specific goal. So that is just so important. And I don't know if you had exact tracking in place so that you could tell how many people were clicking on your sales page as a result of the challenge or not, but could you get into a little bit of maybe any numbers that you feel like sharing as far as how the course launch went, what you might do differently next time, and any tracking that you were able to do?
Definitely the challenge helped. So some of the people who did take the challenge signed up and they did tell me that the challenge was very helpful. And that's why they kind of decided to take the next step and enroll in the course. So definitely the challenge helped. In terms of tracking, first timer, I didn't know. I didn't track.
It's
Yeah, but definitely I had at least five people tell me that they signed up because of the challenge. And I knew these five people personally also because I was interacting with them in the Facebook group during the challenge. So I knew they were doing the challenge every day and they signed up for the course. So I could easily connect that, okay, they had taken the challenge that might have kind of motivated them to step up their iPhone photography game. So the challenge definitely helped. When I for iPhone photography specifically, I had a list of 2,000 people to whom I launched this list. I mean, to whom I launched this course. So the email list was 2,000, the challenge was taken by around 400 people. I think 100 people did the challenge. Obviously, as the days passed on, people fell off the wagon. Yeah, that's common. But yeah, but I think at least I had a special gift for people who completed the challenge. So 50 people completed the challenge full set on all 7 days. So yeah, those are the kind of numbers I can kind of pull off my mind right now. And the sales was good. I had a good group of students join the course. They are loving the course. And yeah, the whole point for me right now is to help them achieve good results using the course. So they feel that they paid for something that's worth it. And I really want this to help their business. So yeah,
That's
it's
awesome.
been good. But definitely, I have to say this. It wasn't a huge launch. I want everybody to know that I didn't make five or I didn't make six or even five figures during this launch. It was a simple, small launch, but I got a good group of students who are interested in the course. So I think that's more important here than any kind of income or something like that. I definitely know that I can do a lot of things in the promotions area. Promoting the course and probably getting more people interested in the course, but definitely getting it out there and getting feedback on the course, I think that was really helpful. Yeah, this time the main thing is done now.
I know. It's like I love it. I love a few things here. Like Number one, I like that you focused on like what I call this like hashtag stay scrappy method, in the sense that you're saying, look, like you don't need fancy equipment. I'm gonna create an entire course and process to show you how to get amazing content by just using what you already have. So I love that, because that's just a message that I think resonates with so many people who are starting a business for the first time, or maybe starting their first successful business venture. It's like, we don't really actually even have thousands of dollars to go buy this equipment and this software. And you're kind of proving, through what you're teaching, and then even through the way you're doing things, that that's not necessary. So you built an email list, for example, ahead of time, so that you would have people to launch this product to. And I'm just gonna go out here on a limb and guess, you didn't buy your email list, you didn't, spend thousands of dollars on fancy Facebook ads to get your email list. So can you tell us a little bit about how you built the email list that really was the beginning of you promoting your course?
Yes, totally. I have to share this actually. So I think one thing I remember when I signed up for your, I think first I started following with your around along with your blog, and I started seeing how you were doing things, and I saw that you were sharing a lot of free, valuable, amazing content, and I was like, wow. Why is she giving all this away for free? I'm like, how, why is she so generous? She's so awesome. But then when I started, this was when I was doing the beauty blogging thing. But then when I started thinking about it as a business owner, when I started my own business, I think every business owner has at the heart, they want at the heart of their whole business, they want to help people. I think that is the first thing. And without any intention, I swear, I had no intentions of growing my email list at all when I started doing this, what I'm just about to share. So I launched my, remember I told you about like launching my new design business when I went full time, when I quit my job. And so when I was doing that, I was like, I was taking new pictures for my website. Because I wanted to take this, I wanted to relaunch my new website and everything. So I just thought I'll take some new shots for the website. And as I was styling and taking the shots, I'm like, you know what? I'm so obsessed with clicking pictures. I'd clicked around 200, 250 shots for that particular photo session. I'm like, you know what? I'm actually going to go take these. They're looking pretty good to me. So I'm going to go and share this with other people who can use those images on their website. So I just
So
put
sweet.
together. Yeah, it was very random. I had no clue. I had no intention. I had no idea what it would turn into. So I just put 20 photos together, edited them, just created a small photo pack, put it on my website. And at the time, I think I had 50 people on my email list just by all the blogging I'd done in 2 years. I had around 50 people. I think 50. I'd like to believe it was 50 to 70 people. And then I just sent it out to them, and I just kind of promoted my new photo pack and my new website on social media. I think it was the free photo pack. I think it was people loved the photos, or I don't know what it was. My email list started growing from there. So yeah, the only way I grew my email list was through free stock photos that I provided month after month. After that took off, I was excited. I wanted to share more. So every month I started sharing free photos with bloggers and creative entrepreneurs so that they could use it in their business without worrying about taking photos and all that. So I just started sharing it for free, and that grew my email list. And when I was going to launch this iPhone photography course, I just wrote an email to my email list saying, you know what, I'm starting, this new topic on iPhone photography. So if you're interested, you can join this. So a fraction of those, the big email list came and joined the iPhone photography email list, and that's how my iPhone photography list was built. But also, I did write a few blog posts, and I did create a couple of content upgrades to promote the iPhone photography concept and get more people into the email list. So, yeah, more or less just content upgrades. I think that is the way I have built my email list. I think, yeah, content upgrades has been everything. Yeah.
That's amazing. So, because I actually remember when you released that first photo pack, because I was like, these are so pretty. I wanted to sign up for it immediately. So,
Yeah.
what I think is interesting here is are a few things for people who are listening is that you started with some kind of non-traditional, if you will, content in the sense that a lot of people, when they think of an opt-in bonus or free content, they're thinking of articles or an ebook or a workshop or this. But for somebody who maybe has a business where they can create photos or templates or patterns, those are other things that you could be giving away to start to build your email list. So I really like that. And another point that you brought out that's just so brilliant is that you used the thing that had been working for you. You had been a blogger for years, and so you created a lot of, I've seen them, they're so beautiful on your site. There's just this series of posts related to taking photos with your iPhone, with your smartphone, and apps that you can use and ways that you can do it. And then obviously all of those blog posts that you're creating are accompanied by their own beautiful photos, which is kind of like selling the concept within, the thing itself. So that's brilliant. Another thing you did that I think is so smart is that you really segmented your list. You didn't necessarily just, send all this information to your whole entire list. You're like, hey, if you're interested in iPhone photography, then come join this other list. So this was a way to make sure that if you're going to send out, I don't know how many you sent out, but like let's just say if someone wants to send out 10 emails about a new course or a product they've released, they can send out 7 or 8 of them to only people who've said, I'm interested in that. And then
Yeah.
they can send out maybe 1 or 2 more to people who are just on your general list or just generally interested in your brand. To see if they have interest in this topic, but it allows you to be more purposeful with your marketing and with your time. So I think
Yeah.
that's really cool. And then you mentioned this concept of content upgrades, and a lot of people will be familiar with that term, but for people who aren't, can you explain what an example content upgrade you did on your blog is?
So content upgrade is something that you give away for free in exchange for an email address. So somebody who comes to your blog finds something interesting that you're talking about, and you give them an extra piece of information for free, so that they give you their email address, and you could probably keep in touch and talk about your, upcoming products, services, and just generally your business, and just keep them in the loop. So yeah, so that's what a content upgrade is. And in my case, following the herd, I did create a couple. Remember, I told you I had these 50 subscribers before launching the photo pack thing. So those 50 subscribers came through content upgrades like checklist, cheat sheet. And I'll tell you, checklists and cheat sheets are amazing when it's relevant to the topic. Yeah, I think the more relevant your content upgrade is to the topic you're talking about, the more they're likely to download. And with my experience, I can share that. So I think I wrote a post about Etsy, on selling on Etsy, because I was selling on Etsy at that time. And there was this little checklist or something I had about setting up an Etsy shop. And that has been downloaded a lot of times. So that was a good thing. But when I came into photography, if I still gave out checklists, I don't think that many people would join my email list compared to a photo pack, because a photo pack was more relevant to my photography. It was like showing them that these are the kind of photos I take or the photos you can take. But if I stuck to probably sending out, checklists for photography, then maybe it didn't work. And honestly, I wasn't smart enough to figure this out before I did it. It was accident. And I figured it. And thinking back now, I feel that it was the photo pack which, kind of made the difference. Yeah.
That's
It
amazing.
accidentally happened. Guys, I'm not smart. Trust me. Yeah.
That's so funny. But you're applying a rule that seems to work, and you're creatively thinking about how will this work for my brand and or my particular content or my particular people, instead of just going, this is the rule, I'm going to apply it exactly,
Yeah.
because that doesn't always translate. So one last thing as we're kind of wrapping up, like I personally am just again so inspired by the fact that you just went out and did this, went out and created your business. You had a lot of options in front of you, and probably some people would have said the smarter option is to get a really high-paying corporate techie job, and or what do you go to school for if you weren't gonna da-da-da, whatever. What is it that, why is it rather so important for you to do what you're doing? Like, what does it mean to you on a day-to-day basis to, I guess, get to wake up and provide the value that you want to provide in the world and be able to connect with the people that you get to connect with? Why do you do what you do?
Yeah, I think I do what I do, to be very, very frank and honest and everything, I do what I do to be happy and just make others happy. This has been my, it's been everything that drives my life is to be happy and to make others happy. That is all that matters to me in my life and in my business and in everything that I do. This is the only thing that I, you know, that drives everything. And I'll tell you a little bit about my background. So I grew up in India. I grew up in India for 24 years. I was in India all my life. And then 3 years ago, I came to the US. So when I came here, I was just following. And in India, I'm from a middle class family in India. So a lot of, emphasis is given to education. Education is the thing when it, you know, in India, at least. So I followed everything that I had to, like a good girl, and I studied. I got a computer engineering degree. I came to the US. I worked here in Carnegie Mellon for a while. And then meanwhile, while doing that, I was like, you know what? There's also another aspect to it. Money is one thing. Definitely, money is something we all need to live our lives. But there's also another thing about happiness. If you're making all this money without being happy, then I don't know, somewhere I feel like you're losing the point of life. I mean, yeah, you're losing it. And I mean, of course, it looks different for each, their situation looks different for each person. I was able to quit the job and take a year off and see if it's going to work. But then I feel like everybody can take a little bit of their time in their day and do something that makes them really happy.
Yeah.
Even if they're not able to quit their full-time job, I'm not going to recommend quitting a full-time job. It's up to an individual, but whatever works for you. But if there's something that makes you really happy, go out and do that, whether it's starting your business, whether it's go visit your friends, meet them, just do anything that makes you happy. And yeah, just pursue that. Yeah. If you think starting a business is going to make you happy, for me, I like that freedom. I like that thing about just doing whatever I want to do. I don't want to get up in the morning and say, oh no, I don't want to get up and go to that office today.
Yeah.
Actually, I before coming to the US, I worked for a firm in India for about 11 months. And every single morning I had to go there, I used to cry on the phone every day with my then boyfriend, now husband. I was like, I don't want to go to this job. I just hate it. I did that for 11 months. And yeah, and he was like, why don't you just apply, he was studying at Carnegie Mellon that time, and that's how I came here. But he suggested that I apply, and I didn't believe in it. I never thought I could get into that school, because that school was a big school, and I was like, I don't know if I can ever make it. But then one thing in the last 3 years I've learned is, if you really, really, really want something, you're going to get it. If you really, really want something from the bottom of your heart, I think you will get it. So I think it's just about believing yourself. It's a lot of hard work. I'm not going to lie. It's a lot of hard work. There are many days I feel like throwing in the towel, and I'm like, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to go back to my corporate job. Looks like that's better. But then the grass is always greener on the other side. It's not always. And I think it's about understanding that this is what you can do right now, and just be happy and do it, whatever makes you happy. Yeah.
I love it. So really quickly, if you will, just tell us where we can most often connect with you online. What are the best places to start to follow along with your work? Where would your course be linked from, in the future when you're releasing other courses? Where would we find you online?
Yeah, so my website is itspinkpot.com. So that's like the hub of everything I do. So you can find my email address if you ever want to get in touch. I'd love to get in touch if, you just want to say hi or just discuss business or just have a cup of virtual coffee. I love talking to other creative entrepreneurs. It like drives me. So yeah, if you're up for it, I'm totally open to just chatting. So yeah, itspinkpot.com is my website. yeah, from there you kind of lead to everywhere else. So that's like, you're down,
Awesome. Thank you so much for taking time to talk to me and to really inspire other people and just kind of share your story. I mean, a lot of the times it's so hidden, you know, behind the scenes, like how much work went into it? What did they do? And especially for people like you who your brand is about presenting beautiful design and beautiful photos, it can sometimes look easy to the outside eye, like, oh, she just has it so easy. But your story wasn't easy. You had to take risks, you had to do some scary stuff, and you had to work really hard. So thank you so much for sharing that with us today.
Yeah, totally. I'm so glad that I was able to come here. Yeah, like you said, we all work in this, you know, online industry where everything's behind the computer, and you very rarely see things, you know, actually how things work in the background. And honestly, I've had so many failed. I told you about how many launches I did this year, and many failed, and some worked, some failed, and that's okay. And things are not always beautiful, but things are always happy, which is what matters. So
That's awesome.
Just be happy and just keep going. And thanks so much for having me.
I love it. Okay, all right, bye y'all.